Nick Hexum back in the studio. 311, of course, lead singer, guitar player, and there's tour dates coming up in Denver, and it's coming up in Morrison, Red Rocks. Oh, that in Colorado, I guess? That Red Rocks?
Yep.
Amphitheater? Yeah. Okay. I don't know Morrison as a town. Atlantic City, I do know that one. It's got the word city in it. and that's a Vans Warped Tour.
Reunion.
Reunion.
The bill is just ridiculous.
What's going on? Who's all on that one?
Oh, you got to look it up. It's so many, but like Blink-182 and Offspring and just all the classics,
wow.
All the new ones.
You know what's kind of nice? For the most part, people aren't ODing like they used to do. Like,
right.
It used to be like, well, you want to see Big Brother and the holding company, it's going to be minus Janis Joplin. Like, there's a lot of minus Jimi Hendrix and a lot of minus Jim Morrison, like a lot of minus, minus, minus. And it still happens, but so many of these guys have kept in like good health.
Yeah.
People are like physically fit. They're going out there, putting a show on. They're not dragging a bar stool up there and going out in their three-wheeler and parking it in front of a microphone. Like, God, everyone's in like good shape. Everyone seems healthy and happy. Nice, right?
Yeah, you know, it's a labor of love, and you gotta be ready to give your best performance. So it includes some training and stuff before the tour starts.
Red Rocks Amphitheater is an amazing place. I'm sure you guys have played there.
We're pretty much permanently booked for the 420 there every year. It's 419 actually, 420 Eve. With like Method Man and Red Man and some reggae bands, and it's
have
that's
you
a party.
Guys, Gene and Brian, had a chance to walk around Red Rocks?
I've never been.
Never been.
It's one of those bucket list destinations.
I'd love to.
It is up there with Yosemite in terms of like natural grandeur.
Love to.
Like you just go, wow. And I was there during the day, and my time there was spoiled by people exercising because it's 200,000 stairs to get from the stage up to the top of the Red Rocks where the parking lot is, and all these asswipes running up and down at all time. Where I'm trying to figure out a way to get. I'm like, how do we get a beer in here? And there's some assholes running up and down the stairs. But that's what people. It is breathtaking.
Majestic.
I can't imagine what it's like on the stage looking out at night, especially.
Well, the air is thin, so you have to have an oxygen tank waiting for you. That's a real thing. But when we moved from Omaha to California in 1992, we stopped at Red Rocks, and like it's open during the day, and we stood on that stage and said, one day we're going to get back and rock this place. And now we played there like 13 times. So,
God, what a dream. Yeah. And what a venue. And I think people, I don't know, people know Colorado's nice and that kind of stuff, but it's not really on anyone's list. You want to go to Maui and you want to go to Mexico or wherever you want to go to, but man, put that on your list. There's a lot to see there, and it's magnificent.
Gorgeous.
Go do the tour. We did the Coors Factory tour and like the whole thing, man. It's fun. The doc, which is out as we, so you can go get tickets at 311.com and find out, Max Pata, who else is on that Vans reunion tour.
Blink 182, Good Charlotte, Bowling for Soup, Real Big Fish, Dirty Heads, Andrew W.K.,
that's right.
It's like party's hard.
Didn't notice.
The doc, which I just saw the trailer for, and it looked really good, is coming soon to VOD and streaming series soon?
Yeah, we had a one-night showing in 240 theaters across the country, like an event, and it kind of turned into like a concert where everyone was like rocking out in the theaters, and we had a premiere here on 311 Day, which March 11th was last week. And we're going to get it out available for streaming in time for the summer tour because it's a lot of fun.
Where do people find the doc?
We haven't made that deal yet.
But we're going to.
Yes.
To
and
be announced.
It's called, what's the doc title?
Enlarged to Show Detail Part 3. This is our third
part
home
three.
Movie.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I just want to make sure it wasn't screwed up. So the doc will keep an eye out for the live shows. If you're in Denver, if you're Red Rocks, if you're Atlantic City, it's all coming up. And you can go to get tickets at 311.com. Has the band been playing like nonstop since the late 80s, or did you guys take time off?
We've toured every summer except one in 1998. We took a summer off and we said, we don't like this. We basically decided to be more like the Dead, where we're a live band first, and we'll work in the albums around that. So every summer we tour, rain or shine, and it just keeps that relationship going with our fans, where we don't have to depend on whether we had a radio hit or anything like that. We just tour, and we are putting out a new album in time for this summer tour, though. So it's a big year for us.
You tell me. I've been thinking about this a lot, because I in a way, I don't think comedy and music and live performances are all so different. I was saying to someone earlier today, but I was thinking a little more personally, but just sort of in general, like the day of the holding deals and the TV sitcom deals and that kind of stuff, which used to be kind of the goal. So I'll do some stand up and then I'll get a sweet TV sitcom deal or holding deal or development deal or whatever. It's like deals, deals, deals. And I think the new world order is come up with a good act, get a good following, and then go out and sell your ass door to door
and keep doing it,
and just keep doing
rusty.
It yeah, right. And I think that's and also in a world now where they can go find something you put in a yearbook from 20 years ago and get you thrown off of your own sitcom, yep, that has your name on it or what have you, find a tweet that you put in 8 years ago. In that world, this one they can't take away from you. Mm-hmm. You have your, there's you, there's the fans, there's Red Rocks, and that's it. Like, you guys can do whatever you want.
Yeah, we were always about being grassroots, because the type of music we were making originally, radio wouldn't touch, because when we first started out, it was grunge only on the radio. And then with us, with the reggae and the hip hop and everything blended in, it took a while. So we said, we're just gonna be grassroots and do it through touring. So it was kind of like viral before that was an actual word.
Did you guys get a lot of pushback from, I don't know, the label or anybody when you decided not to tour that summer in 98? Because you were selling a lot of records back then. They probably wanted you on the road, you know, selling tickets.
Earning.
Yeah, we were just burnt, though. Cause
I imagine you would be.
We used to just put our stuff in storage and not even have a home back in the mid-90s. We would just live on the road. And finally, we said, we need to put roots down, get a house. Mm. We all bought houses in Laurel Canyon and had to buy furniture.
What a crazy block that summer. Was.
Yeah. Laurel Canyon's funny, at least the south side of Laurel Canyon, which you go over Mulholland. Traditionally, that's where all the rock stars lived. Yeah. That's where, like, all the bands and all the bands living together. Mm-hmm. Like, the old days of I'm trying to think
around
of some
the
of the
Canyon Store.
Bands.
I lived right up by the Canyon Store for 15 years.
Yeah, people don't realize that the murders were up there. Wonderland murders were right. That's Wonderland. That goes right down to the general's store.
Yeah,
there.
One of the guys lived on Wonderland. Yep.
Is that the store that's connected to Fresh? The restaurant Pache. The restaurant Pache.
Yeah,
it's a great restaurant.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I have one recollection about that restaurant. When I was poor, and that was my 0 to 35, I took a girl on a date to that restaurant.
It's a nice restaurant.
When it served pizza, and I think it was previously a pizza place. But anyway, she ordered clams on her pizza, and not smoked oysters, just like literally just clams.
Crack them up and pour them on.
And I remember like sitting there going, but the pizza was like a durable good. Like, it was a big ticket item for me back then. And I was like, I know you're going to have one, maybe two slices of this thing. And she's like, I have clams. And I remember going, no, no, don't do that. And she's like, yeah, that's what I want. And I was like, but you're not really going to finish it. And then I'm going to take it home. And then I'm going to clams.
Nobody wants that.
Like raw clams on the pizza. And
it's gross.
It's grody.
It's weird.
She probably had garlic breath, too.
It's my only recollection. Yeah, it was a weird one.
Have we all only been there once? Because I've only been there once, and it was when I was very poor.
Many, many times.
I've been there once, ordered pizza, she got clams, and that was it. You're at home. You delivered your daughters at home. Your children were born at home.
Yeah, I caught all three of my kids, but the second one we were all alone because it just happened so fast, and we thought based on how slow the first one was that we had plenty of time. So we just were like, oh, we'll call her a little later, and then all of a sudden, my wife was like, I need to push. And so I get her on the phone, but it took her about a half an hour to get there. And the baby...
The doula or the nurse or the midwife,
yeah. And so the baby's head popped out, but then she wasn't coming any further. And I had remembered from the whole experience before that sometimes the collarbone will get caught, and that sometimes they have to go in there and break the collarbone to get the baby out. But so I kind of reached in and like rotated the baby, and then she just squirted out. But the cord was totally wrapped around her neck, and she was just blue, like dead baby. I was.
Are
like,
you in the bathtub
out.
At this point?
We're in the bathroom.
Sure.
Delivered on the toilet.
Yeah.
And then.
Water burn.
So I unwrapped the cord around her neck and just jiggle her for a second, and then I heard this, and it was like tears of joy. It was the most amazing experience.
Nick, I have a 2.5-year-old daughter. I had the exact same thought when my daughter was born in hospital for us, but she came out, I guess this happens for all or most children, but I freaked out for a second because she came out like gray and like not moving. I was like, oh my god, she's dead.
Oh no.
And then it took about
one.
A second half later, like, you know, she comes to, but I was not prepared for that. I was freaked out because the kid comes out gray. That's really weird.
Yeah.
The reason I can't fish is because I can't bait the hook. Like when they go, you take the minnow, you put the hook to its eye, and then it runs. I'm like, I can't do that. I can't get near it. I feel for the same reasons, but maybe with a different crew. I can't be around for home birthing. What is it's weird though. I have genes that enable me to do all sorts of things that other people wouldn't do, but this I can't
squeamish
do.
Factor, yeah.
Is it what is it?
You know, I left it up to my wife. You know, she wanted to do it at home just to have a really relaxing kind of spiritual experience, and she didn't want any medication because you have to do it completely med free at home. There's no. Mm-hmm. Anesthetist
right.
at a home birth, so she's just hard.
She's
you know,
badass.
She just she's a badass.
Wow.
This happened to one of my friends who she had her first child at home, and everything was great in one of the little kiddie pools, and put it in the living room, and everything was fantastic, and that's her vibe. And then the second baby, things were happening, and there were complications, and she's like, "I want to have this baby at home," and thank God for the doula, the crunchy hippie granola doula says. Listen to your baby. Your baby is telling you it wants to be born in a hospital. Let's go.
So
you need to hear that every once in a while.
Yeah.
If I said to my wife, how do you want to do this? And she was like, at home, I'd be like, and what else? How about dentistry? Shall I do that root canal for you? We'll just get a folding chair over here.
Card
how about
table.
We let the pros handle it, okay? It's so weird, though. The hospital is such a... It's such a stress factory. Mm-hmm. It's like design.
It's
sounds,
cold and sterile.
The smells and like
loudspeakers.
And statistically, they do a lot of C-sections on Friday night because the doctors
wanna...
yep. Right. Get oh yeah. I was at the hospital causing all sorts of grief for my poor wife because we got like whatever the opposite of what Nick and his wife did. We got like the birthing suite, right? Like get your own room, you got your own whatever. And the nurse came in and I was using the bathroom in the birthing suite and the nurse dressed me down for using the bathroom, explaining the bathroom was only for the patient. And then I did what I'm best at, which is, I think this is costing me a shit bucket of money. And so she gave the, like, the bathroom's just in. And I was like, yeah, noted. And she's like, next time. I'm like, there will be no next time. So skedaddle. Like, what are you talking to me? I just went to I took a piss in the bathroom. And she was bitching at me. And I told her to buzz off. And she was, like, offended that I told her to buzz off. And then later on, my favorite answer, which is, like, when the other nurse came around and I was like, what's Nurse Ratchet busting my chops for over here? I'm taking a piss in the bathroom. My wife's a bundle of nerves over there. We're getting to an argument in the hall because I used the bathroom that's attached to the birthing suite. And then this one. Oh, she does that to everyone. And I said, oh, how about we fire her ass then? If she comes into everyone who's pregnant and screws with the husbands and does it to everyone, how about, here's a suggestion, shit can that bitch.
She's known for being a pill.
And then later on, it was all about cut the umbilical cord, and I didn't want to do it.
Did you do it?
Oh.
He chewed through it.
It's everything that's wrong with our society. First things first. you're going to want to cut that umbilical cord. No, I don't.
You're going to regret it.
You're going to regret it. I have this. By the way, I have a great. I'm greatly calibrated for things I will regret and not regret. And I've never regretted anything that anyone told me I was going to regret and vice versa. So, no, I will not regret this, just like everyone who came before me didn't regret it. So I will not regret this. And they said, oh, no, you're going to want to do it. And I was like, I absolutely will not want to do it. And what if I screw up? Like, I'm not qualified for this. It's like saying, hey, we're flying a 747. We need another guy in the cockpit who knows nothing about aeronauticals. This is kind of stumble around and look at help
flip
out.
Flip the switches.
Yeah, grab the yoke. Go ahead. Have a shot. Take a shot at the yoke. Like, no, you don't need me. I'll be on one of the jumper seats. I'll be going deadheading over here like Tom Hanks in that movie where he's trapped on the island.
There.
Castaway. I'll be over here. Mm-hmm. So they were like, no, you got to do it. And I was like, I don't want to do it. And so I didn't. And then at some point, they removed the kid, handed me scissors, and told me to do it sort of in another spot. Yeah, posthumously.
Ceremoniously.
Yeah, it was like
the ribbon.
Yeah, but the ribbon was being held by two guys. Scissors. Yeah, like I was like, oh, this not as anything. First off, work this into that conversation where you want me to cut the umbilical cord. That's purely ceremonial.
Yeah.
Anyway, but you must have had to really do it, right?
Well, we didn't know what to do about the umbilical cord, but fortunately, we just waited.
They're still connected.
What happened?
Well, it would actually fall off, but we just waited for the midwife, got there a few minutes later, and checked us out. Everything was totally fine, and we ate pancakes and stayed in bed.
Now
you know what you should have done.
Well, that's kind of the new thing, though, is they leave it for a while longer, the cord blood, you know what I mean? Like that.
Yeah.
That's like the new thing now.
You know,
they
you should have done.
They don't clip it right away.
You shouldn't have called the midwife. You should have called a plumber and told him you needed a router service and it was emergency, and just shut the door and just be quiet and just go, yeah, it's all backed up, just sling the door open and just to get the guy's reaction, you know what I mean? That'd be awesome.
That'd be fun.
Blood everywhere, kid on the ground flailing about, cord
the other thing, dropping or whatever it does.
The other thing that's a thing, I don't know if Chrissy did it, but was there any making the placenta into a powder and the capsules or the smoothies or
yep. And yep. You save the cord blood because it's very rich in stem cells in
yeah.
case you need it later
right.
for medical treatments.
Right.
We did all that stuff.
Wow.
Do you
cool.
is it in a bank and it's like
yeah.
Do you put
like
it somewhere
in
and it's
special
like
special fridge or freezer somewhere and you gotta pay each year to for them to save it for you. But if the kid gets leukemia or something where they need stem cells, you're happy to have it.
Mm. I think we're doing that. Max, make a note to cancel that. I want to get the MLB package this year.
That's fair.
You know, it's $189 a month, and it's got.
Someone's
got to
go.
Can't do both
you
ways.
You get the out-of-market games, though.
Yeah, that's what they'll understand. On the off chance something happens. He has a lot of saving. I think they do that with the film and wedding dresses.
Oh,
and,
yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Put it in, like, a fur storage?
There's, like, a professional storage of everything.
God love them.
Absolutely.
There's
going to
be a whole Jurassic World out here, man. I mean, there's going to be a new 311 100 years from now. Like, there's,
right.
We'll definitely be able to, like, make new people, right?
Oh, yeah, we're rich in stem cells.
Yeah, now the question is what, but they're not going to be the same person. Like,
no.
That story of the ox, the guy had. I'll screw the story up a little, but a guy had a big Brahma bull, and it was like his prize Brahma bull, and it was like a trophy winning or blue ribbon winning or whatever Brahma bull, and the guys from like I don't know University of Texas or something came out to clone the bull, and they cloned the bull, and the bull died, the one, the award winning one that was like the guy's best friend, like the rancher's best friend. And they had the new one, and they looked exactly the same, but the new one kept goring him, like kept attacking him with his giant horns. And he is not like he put together a couple of good months, and they think they were buddies again, and they looked exactly the same and everything. And at some point, boom, right in the abdomen with that horn.
Well, think how many factors besides your DNA, which they can clone, make up who you are. You know what I mean? How you were raised, a cold you got at age one, you know, could have sent you on a trajectory. Then you know, you didn't get.
I get it, but with Brahma bulls and like the same guy.
Yeah.
There's a very good Black Mirror episode about this. I highly recommend it.
I think he tore his nutsack at some point. Well, sounds horrible, but I'm saying it's like the Brahma Bulls.
He tore the
huge
bull's nutsack. He tore the nuts of the sick
the guy,
vengeance.
The Brahma Bull has huge horns, and he just like turned it on the guy. Oh, and I guess he's going that for the middle,
sense.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Makes more sense. All right, Nick, hang out. We'll do some news. I want to thank.